車は高崎線普通電車高崎行きです。次は北高野です。お客様にお願いします。車内では携帯電話をマナーモードに設定の上通話はお控えください。ご協力お願いします。
お待たせいたしました。遅れております高崎行きです。ただいま到着の前、ホーム上のお客様の荷物と触れた監督があったため停車して確認しましたが、特に深刻また怪我をされたお客様などいらっしゃいませんでした。約8分遅れで発車しております。申し訳ございませんでした。
Automation solutions running 24/7 in fabs. I'm here in Tucson, Arizona, and we primarily focus on two product lines. One are 3D microscopes, and the other is stylus profilers. Then we also have another division in California that produces tribological and mechanical test equipment. They look at corrosion and wear studies, can automate those and characterize what's going on almost any surface, orthopedic implants down to medical devices or petroleum components. A little bit of interest to the topic today, I'm probably familiar to a lot of you, but you know, why the focus on MEMS, why this webinar? Well, the MEMS market is large and continues to grow at a very rapid pace. So the MEMS equipment market even is expected to hit $500 million in 2012. You can tell that MEMS production is gaining traction because even Applied Materials now has entered the market with a DRIE tool for enhanced MEMS production. And what this ultimately means is there's more players entering the marketplace, there's more competition, and that's creating greater demands on product development velocity as well as quality. And just where are MEMS? For those of you, you know, not familiar with the entire field, you know, one of the interesting statistics I've read, some reports say that an average American or an average consumer will encounter more than 100 MEMS devices today or each day, but at the very least, people are encountering dozens of MEMS devices. Everything from the components in the cell phone that can determine its orientation to the airbag sensors, tire pressure sensors, and environmental controls within your automobile. And so increasingly MEMS are replacing traditional larger devices and providing superior quality and superior reliability for a lot of different businesses. But it's still a barrier to have MEMS devices adopted in certain areas. So most industries actually have traditional techniques that are no reliable solutions. So radio circuitry, mechanical gyroscopes, analog sensors are all well tried and true tested devices. And even though MEMS offers significant, sometimes cost savings, significant performance enhancements, they really have to prove their worth in almost every category. So cost, size and weight, performance characteristics, and reliability. And surveys consistently show that reliability concerns are a primary barrier to adoption of MEMS devices. And packaging and test of MEMS devices remain critical parts of the process. Even after, you know, more than, I'd say, 15 years of, you know, widespread commercial adoption of MEMS devices, packaging and tests still remain about 60% of the total cost of a lot of devices. And that's significantly higher than a standard semiconductor product or a standard component that you'd put in, for instance, the traditional larger components. And just as further validation, a MEMTech report that came out last year highlighted a few areas where, you know, metrology of MEMS devices remains important, remains a barrier. So with MEMS development, there's large numbers of process iterations. Those can take weeks or months. Surface conditions are usually affected by the processing steps. And the device's 3D geometry actually has a significant effect on development problems with the MEMS devices, particularly contamination. And all of those really create a high demand for metrology in MEMS. And just to look at some of the MEMS failure modes, you know, this is a bit of an eye chart, but you can see that each of the different primary MEMS devices have significant numbers of different failure modes that need to be tested and verified to ensure proper device performance. So you have everything from contamination to environmental tree leakages, strange deformation that can happen, outgassing that can affect performance, you know, effects of temperature and electrical shorts. So comprehensive metrology does play a key role for the entire MEMS production cycle. So during R&D, we want to measure the device behavior, sound effects from the packaging typically. During pre-production, rapid, accurate metrology can ensure your feedback loops, make sure your devices are rapidly iterating towards the final design. And then during production, MEMS actually undergo a very high test rate to maintain adequate process control to provide further cost reduction as you're getting problems back into the production cycle, and then also for failure analysis to ensure that any ongoing problems are rapidly caught and the root cause failure discovered. And then post-production, there's a lot of longevity and cycle testing of MEMS. There's lots of tests that go on relative to endurance and environmental analysis. And then MEMS are always being enhanced. And, you know, just the picture on the right comes from TI. And it's a representative or cartoon of the micromirror arrays used in most projectors. And you can see, you know, just the complexity of the devices. There's literally, you know, 10 layers and probably, you know, 15 critical components per mirror, all of which that need to interact with both properties. People characterize feature heights, lateral dimensions, line width, angles, radii of curvature. We'll look at stress,
cross-sectioning.
field of view is.
Again,
this is a blank road, and so I can pick an objective. Technology, and so 3D microscopes actually offer very advanced feature finding software, so they can take an image, they can segment it, and report statistics on each segment of the image. So in this particular case where we're looking at a micromirror array, we can look at tilt, roughness, curvature, we can look at relative heights between the regions, and we can actually look up to thousands of regions within a single measurement and characterize those. And we can also report steps, angles, and roughness for each region independent of the others, and then aggregate it together as one. A lot of medical, particularly in development, of applying the stress of the processing of the treatment. If a device keepers can be dialed in the process, we can very rapidly measure a cantilever array, look at the curvatures and projects of the cantilevers, and determine the stress that's been induced by the anterior deposition processes that the devices are under.
Characterization of mirror arrays. In this case,
This mirror is courtesy of Sandia National Labs. Also, very recently, there's been advanced techniques introduced in 3D optical microscopes that significantly enhance their lateral resolution. So just a few years back, people would say the lateral resolution limit of a typical optical microscope resides somewhere around a half of a micron, 500 nanometers. But with new techniques that involve modeling and multiple measurements, we have a patent technique called the QDXR. You can actually significantly enhance the lateral resolution of your measurements. So here I'm zoomed in on a 10x measurement of the edge of a microview. And on the left, you can see there's some pixelation along the resolution. And on the right, the same exact
Thank you.
components, characterize each of those subcomponents, and really very accurately get down to what is going on in terms of tilts and translation of each subcomponent and see if we can find the problem area. And then I've already shown you guys some of the 3D animation, but being able to take your measurement sequences and put them together into an overall movie is often very instructive. So, you know, here we have a micro gear array rotating, and a lot of times it's very instructive to see, you know, is it translating back and forth as it's spinning? Is it moving in and out of plane? There's a lot that can be gained just from visual analysis, let alone the mathematical quantification. And then there's sometimes that dynamics are needed just to know that there's a problem. So in this case, we have a Texas Tech mirror where they thought they properly etched all the photo resist out from underneath the micro mirror. When you actuate it, you actually see some of the photo resist remains, and it causes severe distortions in the mirror as it's actuated. Again, we can quantify radius of curvature, settling and switching time with a dip for this particular mirror, as well as, you know, what are the heights of the deformation, and we can even model what that does optically. And then, you can get pictures of an ice, but a lot of times you can also make the quantification. So here, for a five center set, we saw the props, I can very easily see the asymmetry of my translation. I only go about two microns in one direction, and I go almost 4 microns in the other direction. I can look at translation B drive voltage and make sure that it's linear or not. In this case, it was not linear within the range. And so if we start looking at our jurisdiction problems or other things going on with the device that need to be handled prior to commercialization. Another very interesting thing is confirming the mechanical models that you use in the development process. So here on the left, someone's looking at a cantilever sensor array, and they knew that it should have resonance frequency around 950 kHz. We actually found the highest resonance frequency was at 950 kHz. The other thing to notice is all the overall motion shown in the video, the deflection to actually match the model. You see a big variation across the cantilever, and we ultimately trace that back down to there's different thicknesses of each of the cantilevers that was unexpected from the process. And so some deflected more than others, and that made some be a more sensitive detector than others. We talked already about the engine finding software, so we take the complex device like you see here, break it into multiple parameters of the lab dimensions, X-ray deflections, distortions, and rotation characteristics. So there's a lot that you can do with your device once you can measure it easily and rapidly and flexibly. You know, there's a lot you can learn from quantification of characteristics. Just another example for beam deflectors. So here we were looking at a series, and what we were trying to do was evaluate crosstalk between mirrors. And so we could activate multiple mirrors at once, as you see here. We also did tests doing one mirror at a time to see whether there was electrical or mechanical coupling between one device and the next. And here we characterize sag, bow, deflection, overall range of tilt motion, things like that. And then unfortunately, this is the one video that I know doesn't work in the presentation. I was unable to locate the original one. But this is an interesting thing where you can even use the dynamic characterization to look at thermal responsivity of devices. This was a joint project between Sandia, MIT, and us, and we wanted to look at an optical switch. And it was very important to understand how it deformed when it was in the off position and essentially a high. of the various devices about the applications in great detail. But one can characterize in-plane and out-of-plane motion, do Bode and Nyquist plots, you can look at lateral dimensions, steps, and roughnesses. And then, you know, over the years, there's a lot of customization and optimization for the MEMS community that has to come into the measurement device. So that's everything from the specialized objective that we call a through-transmissive media objective to look through at encapsulated devices or devices in environmental chambers, all the way to looking at film analysis, having MATLAB and TCP/IP control, and customized fixturing. So, you know, that concludes my talk for today. I'll now open up for questions, and you know, so please hold on the line. So, see what the overall questions here are. So, if you have further questions, love to hear from you.